I suppose it's fair to say, in my sister's account, I have no career risk. She isn't going to fire me.
Ever since legendary investor Jeremy Grantham told WealthTrack how he kept his sister's money safe during the financial crisis, I have wondered, what about all the other women, many of them divorced, widowed, or lifelong singles, who don't have Jeremy Grantham to call upon? Well, we've started a new feature on WealthTrack's website called WealthTrack Women. On a regular basis, investment pros who specialize in advising female clients will answer questions vital to the financial health of women. Look for it on WealthTrack.com. This week on WealthTrack, healthcare expert Katy Votava, founder and president of GoodCare.com, reads the charts of costly Medicare benefits and writes a prescription for a lifetime of savings. Maximizing Medicare benefits is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Luma Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairhome Foundation. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. This week on WealthTrack, we are focusing on maximizing Medicare benefits for you and your loved ones. It is estimated that 90 to 95% of Americans pay too much for Medicare coverage, and we want to make sure you are not one of them. Our mission on WealthTrack from the beginning has been to help you build financial security for a lifetime. The greatest unknown in planning for that goal is life expectancy. Today, men and women who retire at 65 can anticipate living another 25, 30, or even 40 years, all of those years receiving Medicare benefits and contributing to them. The life expectancy of a 65-year-old man increased 2 years between 2000 and 2014 alone, from 84.6 to 86.6. Longevity for a 65-year-old woman rose 2.4 years during the same period, from 86.4 to 88.8. Needless to say, every individual is different. But one thing is certain, as we age, we use more healthcare services. We see more doctors and visit them more frequently. We take more medications. We undergo more procedures, and frequently we need more help. Older Americans cite medical expenses as their largest expense outside of food and shelter, much higher than the general population. This week's guest estimates that Americans 65 and older spend an average of 13% of their after-tax income on out-of-pocket health care expenses. And at the core of those expenditures is Medicare, which is why understanding Medicare and maximizing its benefits is so important in the financial planning process, yet it is often taken for granted and overlooked. No more. This week's guest is Katy Votava, founder and president of GoodCare.com, a healthcare consulting firm for individuals, small businesses, and financial planners. Votava is a registered nurse with a PhD in health economics and nursing. She is a regular columnist for Investment News, a leading publication for financial planners, and the author of a new ebook, Making the Most of Medicare, a Guide for Baby Boomers. I started the interview by asking Votava why it is so important to figure Medicare into retirement planning.
For many people, it's going to be the largest expense they have outside of maintaining their home. And for so many people, it's their biggest worry. So it's like anything in life. If you plan for it, then you have a schema of where you're going to go, what you're going to do. And if you don't plan ahead, you're going to be super shocked on what the costs are. And people, I've seen people get all the way to retirement and say, I didn't know it was going to cost me this much.
Right.
Because Medicare is not free, and it doesn't cover everything.
Talk to us about Medicare not being free. Mm-hmm. I mean, the age-old assumption has been, you turn 65, you're eligible for Medicare, you sign up when kind of when you want to, mm-hmm. and then you start presenting your Medicare card. Not that simple.
Right? No, it isn't.
All right. So how do we approach Medicare to begin with? I mean, who is eligible for mm-hmm. starters?
Okay. People are eligible for Medicare when you're 65 years old if you have enough Social Security credits. And the vast majority of Americans do, whether it's through their own work history or a spouse's. Mm-hmm. There are people that qualify under 65 due to medical disability as well. But once people qualify for Medicare, then there are three major parts to Medicare. They have to decide which parts and pieces they need and when, because not everyone needs everything all at the same time. And there certainly are costs. Medicare A is the hospital component.
Right.
And for most of us, there is no fee for that because we've prepaid for that. But Medicare B does have a premium. And when Medicare started 50 years ago, it was $5 a month. No one noticed it. People didn't even know it was being taken out of the
Social Security check. And what is Medicare B?
Medicare B is the outpatient benefit. It covers all things outpatient, seeing your doctor, laboratory tests, chemotherapy, outpatient surgery, so it's a big benefit. But there is a cost to it, too. And that cost is based on folks' income. It's a sliding scale based on income, and the base fee for people, most people in the United States, is about $105 a month per person. But it goes on up to over $300 a month per person.
And is that monthly fee, can you that be taken out of Social Security, for instance, or is that going to be paid with your after-tax discretionary income or your retirement income? That's a cost that you have to bear in order to get Medicare coverage for all your outpatient services.
It is a cost you have to bear for all of your outpatient services. I recommend people budget it into what they're going to need in retirement. They actually can have it deducted from Social Security if they're taking Social Security.
Right.
Many folks now are waiting to take Social Security until later. So if you're going on Medicare when you're 65, but you're not taking your Social Security until later than that, they will send you a bill, and then you pay that bill. But make sure that you pay the bill.
Right, and make sure, so Medicare Part B is another essential. You gotta get Part A. You got to get Part B.
Part B. And the third leg of the stool is Medicare Part D for prescription drugs.
Right.
And that is required as well. And it's regulated by the government, but it's insurance that's offered by private companies. And there is a fee for that, and it varies. It could be $15, $30 a month. It could be $80 a month, depending on the plan. But there's a huge amount of variation in plans of which plan covers what medication and what cost. So that's where it's critical for people to be smart shoppers and look for a plan that's going to cover their medications at the best possible cost. In every person's opportunity to look for Medicare D coverage, they will look and see 20, 30, or 40 plans that are available to them. So it can be overwhelming
right. When
you go to do that shopping.
Let me stop you and ask you about the enrollment period.
Mm-hmm.
Because the enrollment period is very important, it turns out, which mm-hmm. I did not know, and I'm sure a lot of other Americans before mm-hmm. they enroll in Medicare mm-hmm. know too. Why is the enrollment period, understanding that, so important?
It is key for people to know when they need to enroll in Medicare or when they could delay enrollment.
Right.
And that initial enrollment period is when we turn 65 years old, 3 months before and 3 months after. That's your window of opportunity to get in without any penalties or any other problems down the road. If you don't get in then, you may not need to take Medicare if you're still working and have employer coverage. And you'd have to be working for a company that has 20 or more employees.
So it doesn't help if you're working for an employer who has 20 or less or fewer employees. So
small businesses.
The vast majority of small businesses,
sure.
They're at a disadvantage, right?
The fact is that if it's under 20 employees,
right.
you must have your Medicare A and B. You may not necessarily need the D plan, but you must get Medicare A and B, and that's a thing that people often don't realize till it's a little too late.
Why is it so important to enroll within that window?
It's critical to enroll in that window because that's your opportunity to get in without penalty and have your coverage start right away. And if you're allowed to defer, you're eligible for a special enrollment period later. But if you're not, then your opportunity to get in is very narrow, and you could wait long periods of time to get in for your coverage.
One of the things that's so interesting, you mentioned that when you're signing up for the private insurance for the Medicare Part D, that's your drug prescription insurance,
right.
Is that you should think about what your medications are
mm-hmm.
when you enroll. So, of course, that that's going to be a moving target. You're going to need different medications as you get older.
Yes.
How do we handle that? There's not just one plan you sign up for and that's it for the rest of your life.
Absolutely. How we handle it is do your best shopping when you go into your first plan. Get the best coverage available at the time.
For your needs.
For your particular needs.
Okay.
Right. Because one medication will be very expensive in one plan, not covered in another, but covered fine in another. So do the best you can to get in. And then once a year during annual enrollment, that's a time in the fall, October 15th through December 7th, where anybody can shop and look to see, okay, where am I now? How has my health changed? Are my medications costing me more than they necessarily should? And also, by the way, if a person gets a new medication during the year that's not covered by their plan, they have rights to appeal it, have it added to their plan. The plan has to deal with them in a short period of time. And then if it's not really dealt with, for example, say that medication isn't added, the person may have opportunities there and then mid-year to get a different plan.
How responsible do we expect the system to be to our individual circumstances?
I think that it's key right now that you are an advocate for yourself or the people you're caring for, because notices roll in and they just come out of insurance companies, and it's your responsibility to speak up on your behalf. And then that's tricky because you may be caring for an elder family member. You don't even know if these notices are coming in.
Right.
And so I do recommend that people go online and sign up for mymedicare.gov and can then look at their own account and understand what's going on in that account. You can see what bills are coming through, and it's a really good resource for people who like to work online and particularly for caregivers.
That's a great recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
MyMedicare.gov. Talk about the supplemental coverage. What kind of supplemental coverage should we consider? Mm-hmm. What do we need?
Right. Well, we've got those three basic parts of Medicare,
right?
A, B, and D. And then two main ways to put it together. One rolls into a package called a Medicare C or Medicare Advantage plan. And that does offer some supplemental coverage. And it puts all your Medicare parts and pieces together, the A and the B and the D. The thing is that it works heavily with networks. So it will work well for a person whose care providers are in that network and hospitals are in that network. You always want to make sure best as possible you can get out-of-network coverage. But that supplemental will cover a lot of the co-pays and costs in Medicare. The other main way to go is with something called a Medigap plan. And that's more of an old-fashioned indemnity plan, and it covers on a set schedule the different costs in Medicare. There are 10 styles of Medigap plans, so that in and of itself can be overwhelming for people. They're offered by private companies. My recommendation is that it's a Medigap plan F style.
And what does that mean?
F is in Frank. That's all it is. It's a label for a type of plan. It's regulated by the government. And F, I would think about it as F is in full. It's the most full supplemental coverage you could purchase. It's offered by a variety of companies, and it's all the same benefits. So you want to look at the company that your doctor will process with most readily. Prices will vary amongst companies. So that's another place to do your shopping.
When a client comes into you and says, you know, look, do I get the, you know, the Medigap plan? Do I get the Medicare Advantage? Is there a general rule? What do you tend to recommend? Or do you recommend one?
Well, healthcare coverage is very unique and individual.
Yeah, and it really is. Even with these big government programs, it is.
And so here's a basic preference that I want to know from people is, do you mind going within the network? And it's not just do you mind, we'll do research and say, are your healthcare providers in most of the networks in the area? And if they're not, that Medicare Advantage plan isn't going to buy you a whole lot. You're going to wind up wanting to go out of network, and that's actually sometimes difficult in a Medicare Advantage plan. And if you want the optimum level of choice, you want to go with a Medigap plan, because Medicare itself has no particular networks. That can be more costly, but not necessarily so. It also depends on where people live in the United States. In certain parts of the country, upstate New York, the Medicare Advantage plans are what I would call very robust. Most of the healthcare providers participate in the hospitals as well. So it's comprehensive coverage. In some other parts of the country, you find that the hospitals you want to go to and the doctors you want to see are not participating in those networks.
Right.
And so in those situations, a Medigap is going to be more suitable for people.
So is every state different? Is that basically the way it works?
Medicare varies down to the county and zip code level.
Oh.
So it's not just state, it's regional and down to the county and zip code level. So it is a complicated thing.
That's why you're in this business. But
yes.
how does the layperson figure out, you know, that my county and my zip code, that these are the kinds of plans that are being offered to me?
There's a pretty decent tool called Medicare.gov, mm-hmm. and you go on that website and you can do shopping. And for many people initially, I think it can be a bit overwhelming. You can also call 1-800-MEDICARE, and 24 hours a day, real people answer the phone. And they will answer your questions, and they will actually help people sort and sift to a certain degree and help them identify what's a drug plan in your area, because that can be very complicated. The other really great resource for people is I recommend they go to eldercare.gov. And on that website, you put your zip code in, and that will direct you to the state health insurance information system in your area. Every area in the United States has something called an Area Office on Aging. It has a different name depending on where you live, but they will tell you where to go, and there are specialists right at those organizations who, for free, will help you sort and sift through this.
Why do 95% of people pay too much for Medicare? I read mm-hmm. that in some of your literature.
And that comes from well-done studies from major universities in the United States,
right.
And it is shocking.
95%.
90 to 95% of people in Medicare pay too
right.
much. So they're wasting money. So here we're saying, boy, we feel our budgets are tight, but we could do better.
Mm-hmm.
And how it happens is two main things. The doctors aren't necessarily in the network. We talked about that. But the big thing is medications. You don't want to pick a plan just on premium. You want to pick it based on benefit.
Okay.
And so it's individually looking to say on that Medicare.gov website, you enter your medications into the system there. And it'll hold it, and it gives you an ID number. It's not personally identified with you. And then you can use that list to shop and really compare those different plans. So that's a good place to start. I don't recommend people stop there, because you then want, if you see a couple of plans, go specifically to those plan websites. Because most of the time, the Medicare.gov is pretty updated, but it does change, and it can change. So you want to verify with those companies. But it's very individual, and that's how people overspend.
So the biggest mistakes that people make in handling their Medicare,
mm-hmm.
one is, you just mentioned it, is
mm-hmm.
overspending, and
yeah.
that the drug expenditures are the area where they make the most mistakes. Is that
yes.
right?
Predominantly.
Yeah.
That's one of the two. The second is the network issue, is who are your care providers? Not just your doctors, but you go to laboratories. Ask ahead of time. I've had people say, I'm sent to an MRI. I didn't realize it was out of network. Well, you have to ask. That's all there is to it. And so necessarily ask ahead of time to say, where I'm going for these various tests and treatments. My physical therapist, are they in the network? All of these care providers will have a network affiliation or not. And it's very individual based on the coverage that you have. And it can change year to year. It doesn't necessarily mean that what you have this year, that the networks won't change next year. And we're seeing that more and more, that they do change.
So I'm thinking of, for instance, lab results. I just got
mm-hmm.
a physical.
Yeah.
I should know the lab that my blood tests are being sent to. Right?
You should not only know that, you should know ahead of time, if it's particularly when you have a Medicare Advantage plan, it's key. When you have a Medicare Advantage plan, you really must ask ahead of time, unless it's a real emergency,
right.
is this laboratory in my network? And it's really relatively easy to do. There's a customer service number on the back of the card. You call them up and say, here's a lab that's been recommended for me. Is this in the network? If it isn't, then get a list, and they're on the websites too, and take that back to your healthcare provider and say, is there a lab here that will do just as well? Most of the time, there is.
How many mistakes does the Medicare system itself make?
Mm.
I mean, how carefully should we monitor all of those? I'm thinking about all of the things that my mother gets from Medicare.
Sure.
Is that it's kind of overwhelming.
Yes.
Should each one of those pieces of paper be read carefully? And, you know, should I make sure that the services that she's being billed for, that Medicare's paying for, that in fact she was there that day for that service?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, is there a lot of kind of fraud or waste within the system itself that we should be monitoring?
Yeah, so there are two different questions here.
Right.
One is fraud, which actually is a big national problem.
So I understand.
And mm-hmm. people really need to look at their explanation of benefits. And if there's something there that you absolutely didn't receive, you should report it.
Okay.
But how many times are there errors? There aren't as many errors with traditional Medicare and Medigap, but you really want to look, particularly, I think, with Medicare Advantage plans, to make sure are things being coded in the right way so that it's categorized and paid for properly. And whenever a person's being asked to pay a bill, be very careful and look at that ahead of time and say, does mom really owe this mm-hmm. portion? Mm-hmm. Because sometimes they're catching up with pieces and parts of billing. So that's another place where that Medicare.gov site can be helpful, because it will show you what Medicare has paid on her behalf. And then the insurance company will have its own separate site. So it's one of those things too, it does take a little time to put it all together.
I'll say. Mm-hmm. Do you have a view on AARP? I mean, anyone who turns 50 starts getting mm-hmm. literature from AARP.
Sure.
And certainly this is a huge business for them.
Yes, it is.
You know, is that kind of an, is there any such thing as a no-brainer in going for an insurance coverage by an organization like AARP? Or yeah. should we really shop around?
You know, AARP is a great organization and they have a great reputation. But in fact, what they do is they sell their name to an insurance company.
Right.
So it is an insurance company, United Healthcare predominantly, that provides the health coverage under the AARP label, whether it's an Advantage plan, a drug plan, or a Medigap plan. And so that's what it is. And United Healthcare is a fine company. So beyond that, really, people want to have a brand name that they like. There are some other major brand names of insurance companies. The problem with that is that's where you can really make a mistake to say, okay, I know about that company. I feel comfortable with that name.
Right.
And if you don't shop and then you're finding out that you're overspending, that's a real problem. And yet I understand why people do that, because it's easier initially to go that way. But stay with reliable companies. That's key, because your things will get processed in a more timely fashion. And so I think that that's an important thing. If you see some no-name company you've never heard of, be very careful. I have seen some, and they're probably fine in some regards, but particularly if they're new on the market, one of the biggest problems they have is their networks are so small. I have seen brand new companies that you really haven't heard of, and there isn't a hospital with 100 miles, honestly, that the coverage works for. And what good is that for you?
Right.
You know?
Last question. One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio. Every guest gives us one. What would it be in this area, Katy?
Yeah. In this area, I have a structure to recommend for people to save for their health care and retirement. And it's called a health savings account. And it's actually the most tax-preferred savings vehicle we have in the United States today. Money goes in tax-free, grows tax-free, and comes out tax-free when used for your health care. And people can contribute to that in their younger years and accumulate a balance. I recommend people contribute up to the full amount every year, and they're going to be surprised how much money they have for their health care in retirement.
Now, at one point, there was a use it or lose it with mm-hmm. a related type of account. No yeah. more with the health savings account.
The health savings account is a totally different type of account, and it's a bank account in your name, and you own it. You don't use it or lose it. It rolls over to year to year, and then you have an opportunity to put new money in that following year.
Is it appropriate for a senior citizen, for someone who's on Medicare? And
once you are actually on Medicare, right. you can no longer contribute new dollars to a health savings
okay.
account. You can use those dollars. So people do have to be careful who are in the workforce and working over 65, that they do not sign up for even Medicare Part A, because then they couldn't contribute new dollars into those accounts.
This has been so helpful. It really has been, for a topic that we all thought was so simple and is incredibly complicated, and you've really helped us understand it, an essential part of growing older. So thank you so much, Katy Votava, for joining us, president and founder of goodcare.com.
Well, thank you very much for having me.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is take some time to understand the Medicare options for you or your loved ones. Although Medicare is a gigantic national medical plan with 54 million Americans and counting enrolled, as Votava explained, you need to personalize it to your specifications as much as possible in order to maximize its benefits and not overpay. She made some specific recommendations, starting with enrolling in Medicare on time. If you are approaching 65, prepare to enroll for Medicare Part A and B within the initial enrollment period appropriate for you. The basic enrollment window is 3 months before your 65th birthday and concludes at the third month after the 65th. Of course, there are always exceptions, which is why it is so important to utilize the resources Votava recommends. The basic resources she mentioned are, for starters, Medicare.gov. You can also call them at 1-800-MEDICARE. For information about your own specific plan or that of a loved one, go to MyMedicare.gov. And for information about the Medigap, Medicare Advantage, and drug plans specific to your area, literally down to your zip code, you can go to ElderCare.gov. I also recommend getting Votava's easily understandable, accessible, and relatively brief Medicare ebook titled Making the Most of Medicare, A Guide for Baby Boomers. After talking to her, I feel we all need guidance. Well, next week, we're going to sit down for a rare interview with Dan Roberts, the award-winning portfolio manager of the five-star rated Mainstay Unconstrained Bond Fund, explains how he is taking advantage of the fund's investment flexibility. To see this program again and hear how Katy Votava turned her healthcare expertise into a full-time business, go to our website, WealthTrack.com, and click on our extra feature. Thank you so much for spending time with us. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Luma Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairhome Foundation.